the world doesn't know what to do with suffering. So many people in our country just don't know what to do with hardship and disappointment.
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today.
So welcome to the podcast today. We have a special guest, Joni Eareckson Tada. I very much want each of you to get to know her more personally, and I want the students who are studying through the stewardship curriculum to get to know Joni personally. But before we begin, I'd like to begin with prayer, and then I'm going to ask some questions, and I hope that they are just the right ones. Father, thank you for this opportunity to be together, and we have two or three right here in our recording team, and I pray that you will join us by your Spirit, and you'll guide our conversation, and you would let the words of our mouth and the meditations of our heart be pleasing, encouraging, and edifying to all who listen. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, welcome, Joni.
Good to be with you, Steve, and of course, all who are tuning in today to the podcast. I'm honored to be on.
Well, I read your book probably in the late 70s, early 80s, which made a deep impression on me. But I kind of didn't follow you too much except seeing you in the media and at Billy Graham retreat. I mean, what do you call it? Evangelism things, et cetera. And then in 2006, I was invited to be a pastor at a Joni and Friends family retreat with my wife, Sandy, and my son with Down syndrome, John. And we've been hooked on family retreats ever since. And then I was
I'm so glad to know that.
Well, now I go to 3 weeks. This will be my fourth or fifth year going to all 3 weeks serving the men's ministry.
That's wonderful. Well, it's friends like you who really enrich the culture of a Joni and Friends family retreat. And Steve, I know that you have a great deal to share with men, with husbands, fathers of kids with disabilities. So thank you for your participation in that program.
Well, it's my joy. So I'm going to ask a couple questions, if you don't mind, a couple personal questions, and then a ministry question. The first one is, what is your favorite Bible verse?
Oh, my goodness. That's a tough one. But, you know, I would have to say it's out of John chapter 6. And I can't remember if it's the 54th verse, maybe the 55th or 6th. But Jesus is talking about intimacy with him, and he says the most amazing thing. He says, whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me and I in him. But even the disciples were at first appalled at such a statement, for Jesus to say, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. Our friends can read that. It's a short paragraph in John chapter 6, verses 53 to 58. And the reason I love that passage, Steve, is because Jesus is saying, this is how intimate you need to get with me. You and I need to be so close. You need to be abiding in me so nearly and dearly that it is as though you were eating my flesh and drinking my blood. And Steve, I'll be the first to confess, after 52 years of quadriplegia, I wake up in the morning and I need Jesus urgently, desperately, right away. I mean, I could just ingest his grace. I feed on his strength, and it's as though I were, oh my goodness, let me get so close to you, Jesus, it's as though I were spiritually eating your flesh and drinking your blood. Of course, that's a metaphor of the spiritual life that we enjoy when we abide in Christ. But that's why I love that passage, because it just depicts in graphic language how near and dear and close and abiding we need to be with the Lord Jesus. Just desperately waking up every single morning needing him in a big way.
Wow, thank you for that. About 2 years ago, when you were in Lancaster County, you gave a talk to a smaller group of us, and you talked about how in the morning you wake up before your attendants come to help you, and before Ken greets you, and there's many mornings when you don't want to get up. And then you, this is how I remember it, and you said you have to fight for joy.
Exactly. I think the, for any of us in the Christian walk, to find God's joy, it's a fight. But Jesus says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 3, he says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you," in other words, "you who come to me in empty-handed spiritual poverty, hungry and thirsty for me. Blessed are you, for yours is the kingdom of heaven." That's the very first beatitude. And if we want to stay joyful in God, it's a fight. But I tell you what, the Bible says it's a good fight. It's a great fight. We need to fight to stay satisfied in him. And the best way to do that is, of course, with that John chapter 6 perspective of needing him desperately, and then waking up in the morning, recognizing how poor in spirit we really are, and then going to him in that empty-handed poverty of spirit and saying, "Help me, Jesus. Feed me, Jesus. Pour into me your grace, Jesus. Be near and dear to me today, Jesus. Guide me, Jesus. Hold me by your righteous right hand, Jesus." And it's all about Jesus. It really is that simple. It really is just about him.
Amen. You know, there's a verse that I often quote in the mornings, although it's been much better lately, but for some reason in the mornings I struggle as well. And this is Psalm 90, verse 14. It says, "Satisfy me in the morning with your steadfast love so that I can rejoice and be glad all the day." And I often pray that when I roll over and I'm groaning in my spirit, and God meets me and helps me. So, okay, so if I was to take one scripture that characterizes you, your ministry, and what I received at a Joni and Friends camp and through your ministry on podcasts, etc., it would be Nehemiah 8:10, "The joy of the Lord is your strength." And I'm going to make this comment. I've been at other camps that are not Joni and Friends camps, or other organizations that have asked me to speak on disability, but there's a spirit of celebration that is infused in the family retreat celebration. I'm going to call it a family retreat celebration. There's a spirit of joy that infuses this whole week. And even though there's terrific disabilities and there's terrific hardships and there's deep waters that people go through, there's still that spirit of joy that I think God has helped you to fight for that is infusing the ministry of Joni and Friends. And so I know we're going to give all the glory to God, but thank you for doing your part in passing it on.
Oh, absolutely. And you hit on a good subject about joy. You know, so many of us think that joy is a, I don't know, a fleeting feeling, or maybe just a delightful emotion that kind of flits and here today and gone tomorrow. But God gives his joy on his terms. And those terms call for us to in some way suffer as his dear son suffered when he walked on earth. So if we want to experience the joy that God gives, that heavenly, deep down, rock solid, unshakable joy that is so profound and satisfies the soul so much, then we have to look at our sufferings from a godly perspective. And I think that's why there is so much joy at a family retreat that we hold at Joni and Friends, because there's so much suffering. There's so much hardship. There's so many difficulties and the disability routines that are nonstop, day to day, 24/7, unrelenting. But it is in those hardships that we turn to Jesus, and oh my goodness, when we do, then it's as though he pours out his joy over the walls of heaven. It comes splashing down, cascading into our hearts, rushing out to others in streams of encouragement, filling us, delighting us, and then effervescing back to the Father in a glorious fountain of praise and thanksgiving. That's the kind of joy that we experience at family retreat. But again, the stage for that joy is set when we look at our sufferings from Christ's perspective. And he's the Lord of joy, isn't he? But he's also the Lord of sorrow. He's a man of sorrow acquainted with grief. So it's interesting how grief and joy can go hand in hand when we turn to the Lord.
Amen. Thank you. Well, tell us, we've mentioned family retreat. What are other resources that would be available to everyone, number one? But if you could think of some things, if you were a 16-year-old, what's available for a 16-year-old that your ministry could help them if they wanted to learn how to be a help and a support to those affected by disability?
Well, 16 is not too young to sign up as a volunteer for one of our Joni and Friends family retreats. This year we'll hold 38 across the country, 38 family retreats spread all across the domestic U.S., and we'll hold 39 in developing nations. That's an incredible number of family retreats serving thousands of children and adults with disabilities and their families. And young people tuning in can sign up and serve as what we call a short-term missionary, or STM, we call them. And you can be the hands and the heart of Jesus to a special needs family. You can do everything from hold the tray in a cafeteria line for some wheelchair user, or you can sit with a kid with cerebral palsy in arts and crafts and assist him there. You can get him in the swimming pool, and you can go on a wheelchair hike or wheelchair square dancing. There's all kinds of ways that young people can serve those with disabilities. And it'll give you a heart. It'll really expand your heart for the needy in the world. And it'll increase your sense of compassion. It may even give you a sense of direction, because many of the young people who come and serve with us at family retreats end up going off to college and declaring majors in special education or occupational therapy or physical therapy. And it's a great way to sense from the Lord what his direction just might be in your life. But you know, you don't even have to go to a family retreat. You can even serve in your own church. And there are all kinds of ways to do that as a young person. Anywhere from the young children with intellectual disabilities, say Down syndrome, who just need a buddy to sit with them in Sunday school class and assist them, to perhaps getting a little bit of training and sitting with a kid with autism in Sunday school class and being his hands, assisting him, helping him. Be a buddy to those with disabilities in your church, or come and serve with us at a family retreat.
What about the curriculum Beyond Suffering for the Next Generation?
Oh, absolutely. That's another great resource. And, you know, young people, even at the age of 16, have some pretty tough questions, some hard questions about the goodness of God and the problem of pain and deep disappointment and terrible suffering in this world. How do we reconcile God's goodness with so much suffering that we see in this world? How do we put those two together? Well, our online course, Beyond Suffering for the Next New Generation, tackles those questions. And if any young person listening wants to learn more about this course of study, again, it's designed for younger people, but it still tackles the tough questions. They can go to johnnyandfriends.org and click on our education tab and find out a little bit more about our Beyond Suffering work. So again, I would encourage young people just to go to johnnyandfriends.org and learn more about what we have available through our educational programs.
Wonderful. Well, this is going to be a funnier question, but I'm sure people are thinking it, so I'm going to ask it. So your name is spelled J-O-N-I, but it's pronounced J-O-H-N-N-Y. So why is that?
Well, my daddy wanted a boy, and I was the last of four girls. And so when I got born, my three older sisters all had feminine names, but I got named after my daddy. But my mother insisted that it have a feminine spelling. So even still, a lot of people call me Joni, J-O-N-I, but it is pronounced Johnny. And I'm happy to bear my dad's name all these years that I've been in my wheelchair. He was quite the athlete. And even though I've been paralyzed for decades, I'm pretty athletic on the inside. I can still, you know, sense that if I were on my feet, I could hit the good tennis ball. I could play volleyball. I could go for the layup or, you know, shoot the basketball from the key. I could do lots of things athletically. So I'm so happy that I bear my dad's name.
So his name was J-O-H-N, John?
John K. Eareckson, John King Eareckson. And okay. I was named Joni Eareckson. When I was a young girl, I was called Little Johnny, and my father was called Big Johnny. So I still have cousins to this day who call me Little Johnny.
Well, I watched one of your videos. And by the way, I love all the resources on your website. I have about a 4-second cameo in the one on When Robin Prays. I don't know if you knew that, but I often ask if someone wants to come to family retreat. I notice you have better ones now that are devoted to that, but you get a good flavor just watching When Robin Prays. And of course I know Robin and love her. So, but I was watching one of the videos that just says our story. It's the introductory one in just a couple minutes long. And you close with this sentence, which I watched about 6 times until I got it exact. And here's what you said. Our passion is to see people in special needs families embrace Christ, embrace the circumstances that God puts them in, and embrace life. Would that summarize the Joni and Friends ministry?
Oh, it certainly would. You know, the world doesn't know what to do with suffering. So many people in our country just don't know what to do with hardship and disappointment. We want to avoid it, escape it, drug it. We want to divorce it, institutionalize it, medicate it. We want to do everything but live with it. And how do you live with it? Well, you just don't, you know, quote, resign yourself to your tough circumstances, because that has within it an overtone of submerged rebellion. And you don't want to simply acquiesce or submit to your circumstances. That carries with it a woe is me perspective. So if you're not going to resign yourself to your problems or submit or yield to your tough circumstances with a defeatist attitude, what do you do? Well, you do what the Bible tells you to do. And the Bible says that we are to delight in our weaknesses. We are to glory in our infirmities. We are to rejoice in the fact that we've got tough limitations, for then we know Christ's power rests on us. That's from 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9 and 10. And that basically boils down to embracing, just embracing your circumstances. And when I say embracing, I mean embracing the God, your Savior, who can be found in the middle of your circumstances. So, you know, don't be like the Apostle Paul, who endlessly pleaded with the Lord to take away his suffering. No, finally, the Apostle Paul realized that God's grace is sufficient, for God's power is always made perfect in weakness. Therefore, boast all the more gladly about your weakness, so that Christ's power will rest in you. And that is why, for Christ's sake, we can delight in our weaknesses. We can delight in hardships and difficulties, for we know that when we are weak, in Christ, we can be strong. Again, that's a great summary of 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 8 to 10.
That's amazing. Thank you very much. I just did 3 podcasts on the life of Jacob called Walking with a Limp. And when I was going through some very difficult experiences in 2012, I asked God, am I the only one that has to learn lessons the hard way? And the first person that the Holy Spirit brought to my mind was Jacob. And he's not one of my favorite characters for many times going through the Bible, but he's become one of my favorite characters. And every time I read through Genesis, I see how that man, he struggled, he wrestled, but he was transformed through his suffering, and he was a new man. And I'm thankful for what I went through in 2012. I tell people it was the hardest year and the best year of my life because I learned more about God.
I think if you ever want to find somebody who has a close walk with Jesus Christ, who is great in the kingdom, what Christian do you know who exemplifies an extraordinary life in Christ? Just look for that person who has a limp, so to speak, in a metaphoric sense. And you capitalized that so wonderfully. You really did. So thank you for sharing that. It's a powerful insight. It really is.
Well, thank you. Is there anything else you would like to share with us?
Oh, my goodness. I don't know what to say, except that I'm just so grateful that you've got listeners who have a heart to understand more about what it means to live with a disability. I'm so grateful that your listeners want to know how to make the love of Christ known to special needs families, and I would encourage those listening to keep it up, keep exploring, consider again serving at a Joni and Friends family retreat, or go online to our education and training tab at johnnyandfriends.org and learn more about our certificate course for Beyond Suffering. Also learn about our internship programs. Students and young professionals, we equip them to become leaders in disability ministry. Our Cause for Life internship program provides ministry training and hands-on experience. And so as the young people who are tuning in today, as they plan for their future, consider Joni and Friends and learning more about how disability can be perhaps God's way of helping to shape your future.
Amen. So what can we pray for you?
Well, thank you, Steve. You can pray for my health. I am in the middle of battling against reoccurring cancer, and I was in the hospital for a couple of weeks with some lung problems. And, you know, more than 5 decades of quadriplegia paralysis can put a lot of wear and tear on your body. And yet I so love what I do at Joni and Friends. And I want to have the health. I want to have the strength, the energy and the stamina. My husband, Ken, and I want to continue to serve Jesus through our ministry. So I just ask our listening friends to be praying for my health, that I might break all the records when it comes to longevity and spinal cord injury and keep surviving to keep serving the Lord Jesus.
Amen. Well, I did pray for you pretty faithfully, and I was so thrilled to see that picture of you and Ken up in the mountains looking at the flowers in California, and finding out that it wasn't the cancer. It was an oxygen issue, wasn't it?
That's right. In fact, that particular photo that you're talking about, let's see, I think I'd been out of the hospital just one day, and I wanted to go out and breathe some real fresh air beside hospital air, and we went up into the high desert to see the wild poppy California bloom of flowers, and it was just stunning. So I've got a great husband who takes good care of me, and he's making certain that I do my breathing exercises and use my breathing machine at night and keep my lungs expanded.
Amen. Okay, well, let's pray in closing. Father, thank you so much for this edifying draft of living water that you've poured out today. And we drink freely. Draw us close to yourself. Give us an appetite for dependency on Jesus. Give us an appetite for intimacy with Jesus. And thank you for meeting Joni so wonderfully and bringing her out of the hospital and giving her more energy, more life, more healing. But we join her in praying that you will give her the life that you need from Jesus. Give her the life to continue on, break the records, and serve you faithfully and joyfully for every day that you have numbered for her on this earth. We say amen. Thy will be done on earth just as it is in heaven. And thank you for our time together today and for meeting with us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. God bless you, Steve. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you, Joni, so much. Thanks for making time for us.
Okay, take care.
Okay, goodbye.
Bye-bye.
And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. And a special thank you to our guest today, Joni Eareckson Tada. If you have a question for the show, email Steve at spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. And for more information about Joni and Friends, go to johnnyandfriends.org. That's J-O-N-I and the word and friends.org. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.